So that just, and it's just, Jesus.
The Ramsey brothers is walking.
I'm from Air Force Balbharti.
We don't care. We're talking about boy shit.
Sawan, we had dreams of running with Pamela Anderson on the beach.
Yeah, man. I had a Michael Jackson bad poster up, and then I turn off the lights just to know, feel that there was a girl there because of the hair.
My favorite song of his is "Don't Let Your Sun Go Down on Me."
Yeah, look at this. 1999 jokes. I was still fucking making sense now. Jose, this is not a fantasy party.
Fucking ease up. Oh my.
See, UD, they're gonna cut to that philosophical shit you said 10 minutes ago, and then you doing this. Then that's my problem with following people like you.
But no, I always knew I'd be part of like a group, but I thought it would be like Alcoholics Anonymous or something. But this is good enough.
Okay, one second. We have to welcome everyone. This is going to be a complete utter shit show because everyone on this panel was hired because they love to talk. Now everyone like right now.
I will be representing the coronavirus. please stay indoors, guys. I'm outside your house, guys. Don't come out.
Jose, do that feelings voice, no?
I do.
Everyone's here.
My hand is showing you what my reproductive organs are going through.
I can't make out. Your hand is really small. I can't make out sound.
Guys.
How dare you bring that up? My hand is really small.
Okay, guys, you're going to do this. GK, you're still here, right? Even though I can't see you.
Yes, I'm here. I don't know if I'm here, but I'm here.
Jose.
Wait.
Jose, when I asked you, should I buy a white blue Yeti? You said, go for it.
Good luck, Joey. Good
and
luck.
Every fucking shoot I've done post, the white mic has burnt out and it looks like a... like the KKK is sponsoring me. And you did... Look at this. This is what you let me buy. I asked you twice. Come back, please. Chalo, let's do this, guys. Wow.
Hello, everyone. Channel V and MTV X's. What we're going to have to do is explain what music television was and what VJs used to do, primarily because the generation that is now consuming content has no fucking clue that we existed as a species and that video jockeys were a thing of importance, even if it was just to ourselves, right? So, I'll go.
Wow, music you just shattered my entire existence.
This is how they talk about fossils in a museum. Tyrannosaurus.
Huh. So now we will give Cyrus Sahukar the mic.
Hi guys, I'm Cyrus Sahukar. If you guys don't know me, I am a gynecologist to many film stars and want to talk a little bit about homeopathy. And on this chat, we've cured many celebrities. It's going to be emotional. We're going to talk about childhood trauma and triggers. Many of these people. It's also like the... Okay guys, hi, I'm Cyrus Sahukar. And I used to be in MTV for 10 years and I played various different comedic characters that apparently none of you have seen. I don't know what you guys have been watching. It's just this, it's been about a minute and a half into this interview and my morale, which I've been working on through hours of therapy, has already gone right back into the gutter. I was voted cool guy in my society.
Sexiest man alive.
Sexiest man alive, that's right. My society voted me that. Most entertaining neighbor. And that's
serial masturbation.
That's been my career.
Okay. Take it away, Gaurav. Thank you, Cyrus. Gaurav?
What you do not know is that the location where Jose is sitting is actually under Sahukar's table.
There's better lighting here also.
I'm Gaurav Kapoor. I used to be a VJ when your parents were children. In fact, my career as a VJ started even before there were actual televisions.
Yeah.
Amazing. Moving on to Yudhishthir.
You know, it's just like a reintroduction. I know these guys for 20 years, but it seems like I just got to know them all over again. So, guys, it's emotional for me. Nobody has ever put me on a panel. I don't know how this happened. I think I'm going to like take one of those avatars as we continue with this conversation. I used to be called UD for no apparent reason. I have a really beautiful name. It's Yudhishthir.
And maybe it's as beautiful as your face.
Yeah.
You know. Given the current government, it's a really good name to go with.
Yeah. So they said my name was too long for the television sets.
No, nothing about you is too long. But the thing is that...
You know, other things.
The thing is that nobody there in Channel V knew how to spell And that was just too long a word for them to spell. So they just gave up.
So they used to call me Yuri. And that's what I went by for the 20 years. No, not 20 years, actually.
20 years?
How many years did I spend in Channel V?
Too long.
It felt like 20 for you, didn't it, brother?
I was there for about 5 years. I was with Gaurav Kapoor, Juhi, and Manish. I used to fantasize about Cyrus, who was on MTV. But that was just fantasy. I don't know why I said that, but I knew that there was something going to be happening in MTV soon. There was going to be this mega talent arriving.
1 minute, let me just say, Jose can't read compliments. He doesn't know how to do. Jose, that was a compliment, bro.
Was a compliment. No, I thought he was talking about the time we fired everyone, the mass firing. Is that what?
So, yeah. First time I met Jose, I told him I'm a really big fan of your talent and I think you're really funny. 5 minutes later, I got a tweet saying, just met Gaurav Kapoor, he likes my show, and then he asked me to park his car.
What nonsense, we've never met.
Jose, where did we meet?
Oh my God, I met Juhi on ICQ.
Oh, nice.
This is the
wow,
show.
Wow, guys, we that found the show. Literally that's revealing how old we all are.
The thing about that is everyone here was like, oh, ICQ, yes, yes. I know ICQ. Main udhar hi paida hua tha.
What is ICQ?
We were chat buddies and all.
Bro, it was one of those...
we were ICQ. In love and all. And but didn't work out.
Holy shit, this is beautiful,
why
man.
You got me, yeah. Why do you book me with all these boomers?
But did it go to like first date and all and like...
Yeah. No, no. It was traumatic for her family. So yeah. They kind of disconnected the internet over there.
Someone had to make a phone call, so they disconnected the internet. Okay.
What is going on? Oh, yeah, yeah. I joined MTV. When Cyrus was there, it was already going downhill. So then I joined right after that and I sort of pushed it further.
Just killed it.
We really like... And we took it to the next level, as they say. Usually the next level is up, but then sometimes there are different levels in building.
Yeah.
So... That's what I did over there. And I don't know why I did it. And I still don't know what happened. There was a lot of cross-dressing the first year. And they weren't even shooting. Nobody was even rolling a camera or anything. I don't know what that was about. But yeah, we became MTV VJ. And they started dressing me up in cool people's clothes. So then it just looked like I stole clothes from cool people. And I sort of wore that. So that's what I did on TV for a long time. We did weird things and we worked really hard for the first 2 years. Yeah. And the next six to eight years was mostly just doing nothing. But it was good fun. It was really
fun. Jose, you remember you shot for Channel V also?
Yeah, sorry, I forgot to mention that part.
Yeah, Juhi, he shot an episode and I was with Cyril and I was dressed up as some character. And they said, you know, this Jose has come from radio. Can you just tell him to emote a bit and speak loudly because we can't hear.
Yeah. We let go of Jose.
Didn't do a good job because he still has
that whole day. They only made jokes about, oh, you have what a lovely face for radio and all this.
Wow. Nobody's cross-dressed here more than me. So, like...
Oh, that's I beg to differ, sir.
That's just in the lockdown.
Sir, that's just yesterday. Just yesterday. That's my twirl area. I twirl here. I pirouette here.
Yeah. He's just described my entire wank bank for you guys.
Okay. I'm the Pasha of the pirouette. this is my
guys, this is amazing. Whatever's going on right now is fantastic.
Hi, guys.
Manish Anand, explain yourself.
Explain myself. That's literally how Juhi used to speak to me every time we shot together.
This isn't about this. Let's make it about you.
I had the privilege of watching these veteran VJs and aspiring to be like them.
Hey guys, let's stop referring to age anyway. Okay?
Yeah, Manish, when I was a child, even I watched them. You're right.
This guy.
Yeah, I literally grew up.
I started my career when you were a twinkle in your parents' eyes.
He was never a twinkle. Ever.
Okay, no one's letting anybody speak. Silence, please.
That was the idea.
I basically wanted to be a VJ so bad that I had decided I'm not going to cut my hair until that happens. And lo and behold, I became a VJ. I had a massive afro which covered the entire frame. And that was my identity. It was my afro. Nobody, even when they watched my shows on Channel V, from the past, they will not know my face. They only remember the afro. So that's my introduction, Manish the Afro.
Okay, great. Anu Menon.
I was, Gaurav Kapoor saw me, he was shooting and they pushed me in and said, why don't you like Acha, go for an audition and all. So he had to wait while I auditioned and then he told Amar Deb, who was the head of Channel V at the time, ki, this girl is quite all right. I think you should meet her. So
Amar Deb said,
Gaurav said that you were quite funny. I saw the tape, come hang with us.
So then I thought, I'm not cut out to be cool and say, yo, check it out, coming up next. And I obviously was not P.R. Trivedi to be in a bikini on a beach saying a true song and all. So I said, okay, let's be corrector. And so then they were corrector. And they said, wear glasses. Because at that time, you have to look funny also to be funny. Because no one will believe you're funny enough otherwise. So jokes are not enough. So then I was on character called Lola Kutty. And now we are here.
You just summed up a Vijay's career. Hi, coming up next. That's it. That one line.
Right. We are trying to discuss whether the dinosaurs that were Vijay's, were we the original influencers? We didn't know the term influencers. There was no such.
But without the bank balance, you mean? Today's influencers, that is.
Yeah. I mean, of course, that goes without saying. Were we influencers? And if we were influencers, what the hell did we influence?
A generation, Juhi, a generation.
Very good. We did. Hey, listen,
yes.
I have to tell you that it was so important at that point in time. Just being a VJ on a music channel was so important just by the fact that how many years it took to shake that tag of VJ Gaurav, right? Like UD, for example, I don't know, for years people thought his first name was Vijay, like, cause he was just VJ UD, right?
Yeah.
People thought that. So that's how important it was to pop culture at the time. And I think that when Channel V shut down a few years ago, was it Azeem Banatwala who said that for millennials who don't understand right now the importance of Channel V, Channel V was YouTube before it was, there was YouTube.
Yeah.
I think that was a great line that he said. And I think that just sort of sums it up. So we used to experiment on a lark. They used to just tell us, go out and do fun stuff. And everybody who's sitting here has done it irrespective of which year they joined and when they did it.
Right.
Just give a free hand to do anything.
It's been generational, right? There were like several generations of video jockeys and there was a lot of creative freedom right at the beginning, you know, when music television came into India. If you had to put it in a box, just so that people understand, what did we influence? Like, what did everyone collectively influence? Like, it wasn't just music. Like, what were we doing that was affecting people that much?
I didn't know this would be a group therapy session in my entire life.
I realized later that it was actually really, really important because it was generally covering the youth. It was these guys, at some point.
Yeah.
Especially, I'd say, actually, especially just before all of us got in.
You got him in UD, were there like from 2003, 2002?
No, I was there from like actually 2000.
2000?
Yeah. All three of us joined around the same time.
We did. In fact, we were the crossover generation because
exactly.
Before us, there was, you know, people like
Danny Miguel.
Sophia Haak, you know, all the train, all these really, all international and all super cool, right? And I think the only Indians at the time who sort of, there was Ranveer and Vinay who predate us. There's Chinappa and Brocha on MTV, probably predate our generation. I think they were still sort of almost novelty value and it was still always an international thing. And I think when we came in, the brief we were given is, that's the first thing. When I was asked, will you be a VJ? I said, well, I don't know how to, like Anu saying, right? I don't know how to say yo, cool, or, you know.
And look at us
next.
Now. All we do is say yo and...
All we do, man. That's something I only talk in your speak. And they said that we want to make it more approachable and it has to become more people next door, boys and girls next door. We're done with this whole sort of cool, almost colonial hangover kind of international people talking to us in an accent. Now, Indians will talk to us in an accent. So that's what we're going to do. So that's the crossover generation.
Yeah, it was very interesting. It was very, very interesting because he's right. And it was happening where, and I think that like people like, say, Brocha and Chinappa in... at least in MTV, were those guys given that mantle at the beginning, where they were like sort of making it about the youth and about they were going to college fest, covering stuff, and they were inspirational. I mean, I used to watch MTV, you know, and I remember I was on MTV for a show called MTV I think campus or something, because I was in
MTV U. So MTV, it was called MTV U. Right. My first appearance and your first appearance.
That's right. That's right. And Cyrus Brocha was like the host of MTV U. And yeah. I can't tell you, man, I was so excited to be on MTV U. And it was like instant 2 minute stardom, because for like 30 seconds, we were a band that they covered. I didn't even speak. We were in a montage. They used to do a lot of montage scenes. So it was something which was also, India was changing. You have to, I think, see where India was. Like India was in a time. The TV explosion had just happened. Everybody wanted to do new things and it was kind of covering it. So in many ways, these networks became a representation of the change that was happening, and also that we can all be nuts and badly dressed and normal people can also be on TV.
Channels like MTV and Channel V are constantly pushing the envelope, constantly creating new things, constantly thinking out of the box. All, most of the content, that, I mean, with all due respect to everyone who's creating content right now online, and let's say, you know, a lot of them are really good, but most of them are all rehashed, sort of repackaged things that have been done either by a Channel V or an MTV, which were initially the trendsetters, whether it was content, whether it was, you know, a haircut, whether it was the kind of clothes that people wore. So I think youth television at that time was basically influencing a lot of aspects, even lingo. But I feel like VJs would have been the original influencers or trendsetters is because of the originality that each of them brought. Like everyone on this panel right now has been so different from each other. I mean, back then it was just, you were basically on your own. You were figuring it out. It was you and your producer and that's it.
I think there were far more restrictions, not just in terms of a budget, but also in terms of what you can say, what you can't say. Because if you even, as Lola, sing one line of a song that's for Yash Raj, we have to pay them a lakh and a half. Like, you know, it was just like bizarre.
Right. You're right.
And the thing is, now I find when there are so many characters now, right? For at that time, I think it was a hierarchy. You either went to Miss India, then you decided to become an actor or a model. You were a model, then you became a VJ. Now you're cutting the middleman completely and you're going straight to YouTube. Yeah, you're going straight to your YouTube channel. You're going straight on Insta. So you don't need anyone else to help you. If you're good, you have an idea, you just go with it. There are no levels. There's no, please, I think we should do this character. No, but it's not a good brand fit. No, but please, can we try it? You know, that's gone completely. So now it's that weird space, like to the end even, like the head of Star TV was like, what is this character, this Lola? I don't even understand why we have her on the bloody channel. Like, I don't get it at all. So then there was like the boss saying, no, but it's a good thing, because anyway, Channel V was loss-making. Now you needed one loss-making channel in a bouquet of great channels on Star TV. So
you and Sahu, is that you were Lola Kutty, this whole different avatar on TV, and Sahu, you played so many different versions of, you know, avatars of whoever you chose or whoever your creative team chose. Now, when you're presenting like that,
team.
Which is you.
Because
this is
Sahu and
all
his characters.
Like, just a classic.
Simi Girebal was all you.
I like that. I'm going with my creative team because it sounds so good.
Simi Girebal was all you?
Simi Girebal, just a quick example of how things progressed was that we were going to do Vikram or Baital, you know, the classic series. Yeah. And Cyrus Brocha and me were always thrown in together. It's about 12 at night. And this guy Morris is white shirt. And we started spoofing Simi Girebal. And there was no script. And and now people who are seasoned actors who were writers then, Shareb Hashmi, Family Guy and whatnot, was on that show as Anu Malik. How do we find Anu Malik? We found a curly wig and put on his head and then tied beads. It was that much of an improv situation. And then it started progressively doing well and people put all these wonderful ideas.
It blew up. Completely. Yeah,
Because Cyrus and gang would do these things, then by the time we came onto TV, they were like, okay, guys, now we need people who can also produce and be behind the camera. Please, we don't want this Vijay Giri from you. Please, thoda band karo ye sab. Cyrus and all have done this too much now. So then we were forced to do that kind of labor because of you.
My first 4 years, I would just get told by everybody that, bro, now you have to be the next Brocha. You have to try to be the next Brocha. And I'm like, I don't want to be the next Brocha. Brocha doesn't
want
to.
What the hell? They said the same thing to me.
That's right.
So said the same thing to me in Channel V.
He was...
But you were our Brocha. What the hell, Gaurav?
Basically, nobody you were there, really Brocha, liked Brocha. Bro. So they just wanted somebody to take his position.
And so there was always that, there was that handover situation happened. The first 3 years of I don't know about Channel V as much, but MTV was just throw them on the road and then they'll find themselves.
Literally, you know, I hated it when we did it, but that first year, they got like a bunch of producers. We went to every single college, even places that had not yet started teaching. We were in their campuses talking to the college.
Like Geo University.
The dean and all. And I remember thinking, man, this is so painful and stuff. But now in retrospect, it was actually, every time we'd go to a college, I'd have people coming up to me and saying, oh, bro, you are a VJ. Shit, if you can be a VJ, even I can be a VJ. And I was like, bro, thank you so much. That's kind of half an insult, but okay. I like it.
Yeah. And all compliments were half insults. There was no way it was. No,
they would tell me, hey, Bani, you're amazing. And I'm like, I'm not Bani. Please stop it.
Had we had social media back then, say 10, yeah. 15, 12 years ago, would it have still had the same impact? Or do you think there was a...
I think it would have been much bigger.
Much, much bigger, yeah. Like MTV went all out. They started a show called Fully Faltu, which was the first, like, let's officially start spoofing everybody. And Brochag became the, I'll do the improv comedy part, and all characters sort of came to me, right? And we, if you look back, they were also exactly the, so carrot, monkey, dog, I played furniture, all kinds of stuff. And if you look back, they were pretty much identical to what you could cut into and do pretty much on Instagram. They just didn't have the other podiums. But if you also think about it, it was a great privilege then, because there were only one or two networks to come to look at any spoofy material, to get to play characters. It was all towards you. Today,
back then we had VHS recorders, so the only way to sample content and get influenced by new trends was actually waiting for somebody to fly in from, let's say, America, Singapore.
Yeah. Wilson tapes.
Yeah, and give us the latest Top of the Pops. We used to watch that. And
now,
say,
now 23, music. Now 12.
Now 647.
Yeah.
You know, so we took that information and then we went to TV, which was just exploding. And then we brought that information into our own sensibilities and presented a new version of the so-called youth culture. And now the youth are doing their own thing with the technology they have. So I don't think, you know, anyone is doing it incorrectly or worse than the other or better than the other. They're just using what's available to them in the best possible way and expressing themselves.
Like current content creators, not all, but some of them, man, they bring it every day. And that blows my mind, man. That blows my mind. I could never bring, like, I used to do chunks of armored work, but to bring it and produce it and create it and edit it every day, that's hard. That's hardcore stuff.
That's the other thing.
They're born into that world, Sahu. They're born into that world. Like for us, social media, I feel, is an effort. Like it's an effort. Like Anshumore has this great joke when he's like, you know, I have friends in their 40s. Like they're ajeeb log hain. Khana aata hai aur wo sirf khate hain. Matlab photo nahi khichte. And that's like was so telling because it's true. We, you know, that's the difference. Like if it was a younger person, the food will come. They'll have a whole Insta story on it. I feel it's a bit of an effort to remind yourself, I'm going to take this for my Insta story today. For these people, it's an extension of their right hand because they're younger and they're born into that world.
I feel like the world is ending. So why waste time creating content?
There's, you actually, see a log, everybody's doing an Instagram live, right?
Yeah.
And I look at that and I go, kiske liye bana rahe ho yaar? Sometimes you go onto some Insta live and there's 7 people watching. I said, even your entire family couldn't be fucked to join this. Right? Yeah. What the hell are you doing this? This was a phone conversation.
No, that's a great
talking
point.
To yourself. Don't do it.
What Gaurav is saying is, there's so much quantity of content being produced, there's very little quality. Because everybody's putting out things so rapidly. There's no real thought. There's no real ideation. It's just, they want to be seen. They want to be heard.
Dude,
but
I have
not
a problem that I think most creators are not thinking of the viewer experience. Right? Yeah. You really need to think of the viewer experience. Just because you have it, just because you have the editing software, just you have to make conscious content and quality choices.
The times are now created in a way that you're serving an algorithm as opposed to serving any form of craft.
Exactly.
And I don't even think that they enjoy that. I mean, I can't fathom that if I had to friggin' come up with something fun or interesting or fascinating all the time, it would be a fun experience for me. It would be exhausting for me, right? But they're serving an algorithm because your content, your whoever's telling you to become popular says the more you post, the more people reach, the more followers you get. So the algorithm is taken over. And that comes in the way of some form of creativity because you don't get the chance, man.
No, if you have 500,000 followers, that's your income. So every day you're posting something. And that's why like...
But
Jose
Anu, they also suffer from it. I'm sure no content creator enjoys that. I mean, I'm sure it's a painful experience. If you told everybody,
guys
post one
so
great
like
video
we
a week.
Shoot every day.
We used to go, here's the thing, we never served an algorithm. We always said, and the thing is, because we had brutal editing, sometimes you could shoot 16 hours for you to put 10 minutes on. You had that liberty of doing that at that point in time. Right now, people don't because they don't have that much time. It's like, dude, I'm going to shoot for 12 minutes and I'm going to put 10 minutes out right now. So that's the difference today, because you're fighting.
But GK, that call also has to be taken by you at some point, because I remember that they would go through the ratings of your show and they would go through individual popularity and they would sometimes tell you, you know, you're not doing well, you need to do better.
But Sahu, you were buffered by your creative head or whoever would keep you away from that on some level.
On some level. Yeah.
And you know, so you're not always serving the PRP.
You could open a screen and say 500,000 people watch me for 1 minute only in a 10-minute video.
And I'm always curious, like psychologically, that could really fuck my head up. You know what I mean? Like immediately getting response to everything I'm doing. Every second is judged, right? It's like being on stage 24 hours a day. And that's really tough also. I mean,
I want to ask Jose this. Jose, you put out a lot of content and you do a lot of like on the fly stuff. I'm assuming a lot of it is very quick. So what is your take on this? Because
I find it extremely exhausting to like be on all the time. And honestly, again, you know, the way things are going with the world and shit and we're all dying. I feel like we shouldn't spend too much of time on the frivolous shit. And of course, we should put content out and, you know, make money and stuff like that. But if it's going to really mess with your own mind, then I don't think it's worth it.
What if that is your soul, not soul, but what if your roots of like making money, right? Like that.
It is.
So then when you sit back, right, like, and you say that I don't really feel like doing it, you know that it's counterproductive in more ways than one.
Can I just answer that question 1 second? The thing is that I crunch a lot of data because I run a content company, right? And we have people who do this. Can I just tell you one thing about this? Is that there is two people you're serving. You're serving the algorithm, right? So that's your distribution platform, and you're serving your viewer. You have to make a choice at one point in time. And I've realized your viewer does not care for quantity. Your viewer cares for quality. It is Facebook and YouTube and Instagram and all these people. It serves their interest if you keep putting stuff out.
Correct.
And make you believe that it is a quantity game. It is not. Your viewer will find you because of quality. And he or she will unfollow you because of quantity. If it's only quantity without quality, they will unfollow you. I've realized that. We realize that whenever we put out content and we put it out for quality, we have, apparently our shows have the highest retention rate on YouTube, we're told, in terms of percentage or whatever, right? They can quote you jokes that they like. They'll quote you stories and incidents. Therefore, the viewer will find you because of quality. So you can choose to listen to the monoliths who control the world and saying that keep feeding the beast with quantity. But the viewer wants heart.
What if this is how you make money? And it is how I make money. But I'm very fortunate and privileged to be able to make that choice and not be like, you're content all the time. Which allows me to also then say, okay, this is not that great. I don't want to post this. Or, I'd rather chase after putting this out because this is so much better.
Do you feel like at some point you feel, I've pressured, like I'm a slave to misheard lyrics, because that is something that people always want to hear. So I don't want to, if I'm scared that if I come up with something different.
Nobody accepts it for the first 2 days. They'll say, what is this? By the third, they're sending you requests. So that's everyone.
My inboxes hate change till they love misheard it. Lyrics. Yeah, my inboxes are filled with only like misheard lyrics. Sometimes I think people are abusing me, but they're just sending me misheard lyric suggestions. And that's how it is. So, I'm happy to take the low hanging fruit also. You know, misheard lyrics is very low hanging. It's so easy. It's so easy to do.
So that just kind of like, and it's just.
I have a
business. Manish, why don't you take that?
The Ramsey brothers is walking.
Okay, moving on from that to a question that I'm posing to all of you. Why did music vlogging not take off?
Can I take this?
Yes, take it. Take it.
Nobody wants it. Take it.
Tell us what the question is also while you're at it, Yuri.
Keep it in a drawer.
Vlogging. I recently saw one really cool Insta feed where this actor, his name just kind of eludes me right now. But he's a very popular actor. I'm trying to figure out his name as I think about it.
But what he does is he takes three LPs that he loves listening to, that he's selected over the week, and he discusses that music. It's probably one of the most amazingly interesting Instagram, IGTV thing that I've seen. Sorry, it's Kevin Bacon. He does this thing on IGTV.
60-year fucking career.
Kevin Bacon. Oh my God. So UD had me at this Insta IGTV thing.
This is a very popular actor, popular guy.
Very footloose kind of guy.
But you remember him from
20 years of knowing him. This is not new for me.
Because I had Patrick Swayze coming to my head, but I said, no, that's not the guy.
Yeah. Not the dead one, the alive one. Yeah.
That's hysterical.
So you gotta check it out.
Patrick Swayze is vlogging then. I don't know what you're watching, bro.
guys, I just want to say that Mr. Chidambaram, what do you have to say for yourself? Look, no, coming back to the discussion at hand that Juhi's really trying to get
us. I'm sorry. Everybody say
is
sorry.
That back in the day, if you wanted many people to hear your opinion, you'd have to either go to a newspaper, you'd have to go to a news channel, or you'd have to find your VJ friend who will take up your cause and talk about it on television, which rarely ever happened. Then you had college students who'd look at VJs as almost like their spokespersons for things that they care about. And then over time, then we moved over to everything going over to the internet. And now everybody has their own TV channel or their own radio station or their own broadcast medium, so to speak. So I think that's where that whole change happened. And now it's a good thing and it's a bad thing. And everyone has the ability to now run their own broadcast medium. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk.
Guys, I have to tell you that there's a lot of excitement here in Silicon Valley.
How is everyone doing this? I also want to do this.
There's a lot of excitement here in Silicon Valley about your ideas, Jose.
It's actually the source where you're getting your information from. So I don't want to follow a blogger who doesn't have the in-depth knowledge. Like, let's say, Brian Tellis, if he did it.
Zone of influence. You have to prove your credibility now, right? Unless you prove your credibility. Listen, man, it took me four or five years to prove my credibility in cricket. Like, that I knew what I was talking about, right? When I started.
Really? Did it actually take you that long?
Of course it did. Right? It took.
But
it,
that's he has a deceiving face.
Yeah. So it sounds like I know. Looks like I know what I'm talking about.
No, I just want to say that some of the stuff that Gaurav has done with cricketers has been the realest stuff in terms of you see a lot of interviews and stuff, but the stuff you've done with the
Kick-Ass
is amazing, yeah. Amazing stuff.
Yuri, has my programming resonated in outer space with your friends?
Hey, dude, I also tell me how do you do this background stuff? Yeah.
Okay. Iris, you can call me at 2 in the morning, I'll tell you.
Ask him tonight.
Now, just throw your voice now, he can hear you. You're Nietzsche only.
Okay, Yuri, take this.
I don't know if I can take more of this.
Saukar, just say your voice is, it's obviously voice activated. Just say activate virtual background.
Activate virtual background, you bastard.
It's coming. I can see a living room behind you.
You're shit. You suck.
Sorry, I'm emotional. I really want a background. I'm tired of this. I want to be where UD is.
This is a case study on how quickly VJs are distracted by things.
Yeah, Juhi, then next question, say na.
Juhi, I want that background, dude.
But these grandfathers have just discovered virtual backgrounds.
See, UD, they're going to cut to that philosophical shit you said 10 minutes ago and then you doing this. And then that's my problem with following people like you.
But
that's my thing. See, I follow UD. I think he's a credible guy. You know, he's going to give me good information. Then I see footage of him freaking doing a backstroke at an imaginary beach.
Hey, Oblix is here.
Hello, who's here? I'm clapping.
It's been higher.
It's stuck on the mic.
Hello? Is it Oktoberfest?
But Juhi, notice how these content creators don't share their secrets with other friends. Like, they won't tell you how to get these filters and stuff.
Just go to snapcamera.com and get the snap camera for this, and the other stuff is in the background.
Now, okay? I don't know.
So I want each of you to actually answer this question. Like, how important is fandom to you? How important is people loving you for what you do for you to keep doing it? Because fandom now is going into millions. We're talking 60, 70, 80 million people who are rabid about, the people that they follow. So I'll take Gaurav and Jose for this, because Gaurav and Jose have a very, like, very different fan base, right? You're like primarily cricket, and you are...
Mine are sexy ladies.
Yes.
And me is for like abusive words in nice songs.
Yeah. So my question is like, what are your fans rabid for you? Like, do you don't take it literally. Do not take it literally.
I think a majority of the internet is rabid, so that there's an overlap there. There's like one is a subset of each other. But we'll start with, I mean, it's this will be very hard to believe for many people, but I had many fans when I was in radio because they couldn't see me. And I remember so in between when we were doing radio, there were a couple of girls who showed up at the office. And first I was like, wow, girls, amazing, girls, superb. So they came over to the office and they said, humko Jose ji se milna hai. Hum unke bahut bade fans hai. So somebody came into the studio and said, Jose, come on out. There's some fans who come to meet you and stuff. They just want to say hi. So I came out and I said, hello. And they just looked at me like that and went, nahi. So I was like, what? Nahi?
No.
Yeah, it was literally like, nahi chahiye. She said, nahi, aap nahi ho sakte, Jose ji. Nahi, aap nahi. Chala, hum log ja rahe. And they left. This has stuck with me for many years. My therapist talks to me about it.
For a group huddle.
So that group was, up, group that up, was fandom. Up. Fan. Thank you guys. Thank you. That's very quiet. Nice. So that was fandom back then. I even had like one really lonely guy who showed up at the MTV office and he would wait there at the reception.
Suresh Menon, right?
Yeah. Then we asked him to leave and now I do videos. And then the internet happened where people can now just send you a message, you know, like the first time before you block them, they can send you a message and you have to read it. So now people are, they're like, oh, wow. And they just type you a message saying, hey, teri gaan mein dal dega, madar chod gaan mein dalo. So I think that's how it has changed over time.
But actually, because it's a face behind a screen, they're very toxic.
Yeah, some can get really toxic, man.
Of course, man. Social media has made every anonymous person who has no one to listen to them, has given them a stone in their hand and they're standing on the side of the road and they see a shiny car coming and they just throw the stone. Absolutely. And when you ask them, why did you throw the stone? They're like, I don't know. Yeah. Did you not like the car? I don't know. Did you not like the person driving? I didn't see the person. Then why did you? Just because I have a stone in my hand. So I'm just going to throw it.
People don't even know what they hate. They don't even know what they dislike.
They never take that seriously.
What about you equated with the sort of love that you get, like the adoration that you get? Like, see, if you get X amount of adoration for your thoughts, opinions, who you are, etc. online.
It's just that the hateful messages are way louder and normal people, they don't take the time out to tell you that, hey, man, don't listen to that hateful message, or hey, man, just, everything is good. Life is great. And, you know, people are nuts. But the loud people, you'll find them everywhere. It's like they say, you know, the empty vessels make the most noise. It really is that. I genuinely feel that that's the case.
I think for me, starting off being, you know, we were with a youth channel. We were
Manish, sorry. Before you answer that, I just want to say, I'm a huge fan of your acting. You're really talented.
Thank you so much.
Me too.
Thank you so much, guys.
Lovely.
Thank you so much. See, this means a lot to me. No,
this is what we're not getting from the internet these days.
It's surprising. I don't know. Maybe I didn't experience it earlier because I wasn't heavy on social media. I'm still not. But I think now that I do try to be a little bit more active, the kind of feedback that I do get about whether it's my craft, about the way I look, whether the way I carry myself, positive and negative, it's mostly a very constructive. We have worked with youth channels where comedy was a huge part of what we did. We learned to laugh at ourselves a lot. We developed that ability to just make fools of ourselves. So I think that aspect of the negativity that comes with being exposed to people, being open to people, I think that is something that at least I feel for me has filtered out quite a bit. It is a huge part of what I do, but it's not the primary reason behind what I do. I'm not doing it for the fans, or I'm not doing it to generate or gain a fan following. I'm doing it, fortunately, I can do it because I really love doing it.
Anu, going to you, you're doing stand-up.
I just want to add before Anu starts, I think this is really important, you know. This is what fans basically, they get a feeling from you and they express it through a certain appreciation. So Anu, you know, when you were seen on Channel V as Lola Kuti, I was blown away, primarily because there was such thought gone into writing and performing that character. I could only imagine 2-3 people that I'd seen and equated. So Javed Jafri, who used to do all these characters in his show, and then seeing you doing this, and Uddham Singh, and seeing you do this, I was like, seeing a woman do this and not worry about how she looks, not worried about, you know, but come across as this strong, really fun.
And in a primarily male-dominated...
Yeah, and I was like, wow.
Important but voice
also, like,
in society.
Just an accent, like I always say, would not work, right? It's a part of it. Like, everything comes in a package. So it's about what a thought process is, creating a backstory for a character, how you answer, and also it's a sustained character. You are taking and putting her in different situations.
Yeah.
So it's and not you, just about, oh, she pronounces this in a weird way. So I think that's always...
At least from this one, it comes from the artist, because no producer... And no writer is interested in worrying about anything else but the stereotype. Just do the joke, get the laugh.
Yeah.
The rest of the stuff has to come from you. They are very happy with what they're getting out of it.
The thing when I started doing stand-up is that I think so many people were used to Lola as a character. So it was like I was disappointing a large section of people, because now they were like, oh, she speaks normally and she dresses like, and she's wearing a dress and, you know, speaks. So even when you talk about a comedian finding a voice, like, who is Anu just on stage cracking jokes? So I think that was also a journey for me. And the kind of jokes I do also, maybe because I'm from a theatre background, is always story-based. So everything is a story. Of course, there's an element of exaggeration, but it is actually something that's happened. There is a beginning, middle and end. There is an arc. So whether it is talking about husband, in-laws, kids, whatever, that is the space I live in.
Transitioning from a character on TV, which was very loved, and then starting, not from scratch, but starting almost new in a space that you're kind of used to. How has that been? Has it thrown you out of your comfort zone, or have you not really cared about?
I don't. I mean, look, this is the only thing I know how to do. So I'll do it. Right. So there will, I'll always be performing to a niche audience. That's fine for me. Like, once I was doing a show, I was just hosting. Terrible. It was going terribly. It was an international audience. They told me I can't say a whole bunch of things just as I went on. And there was one Indian dude in the audience who said, I much preferred you as Lola.
Damn.
There's a comedian in Bangalore who's possibly 8 years younger than I am, like 7-8 years younger. So she's grown up watching, say, characters on, and grown up watching Channel V and MTV. So she does a Malayali character right now. Which is pretty much the same, wearing the sari, gajra, excuse me, glasses, all of it. So someone said, oh, why don't you, you know, like ask her why she's doing it? And I was like, what difference does it make? For a new generation who doesn't know anything about this character, like she was probably their Lola, right? But I always find it bizarre saying that you've grown up watching this character, why wouldn't you do something different? Why would you do like a carbon copy, cookie cutter, same thing, like give it a spin, jazz it up, make it more modern. But if you're just doing the replica of, that is for me quite boring. And also you want to think as a character. I think that's the difference. Not think as you. It's not like Gaurav, thinking as Gaurav, as a character, he'll have to think and give an answer.
You all have any crazy fan stories, like any bras on your face? You especially, Anu. Any stories, like any psycho fans? Like,
I think Jose has had Sahu's bra on his face a couple of times.
I did a show a couple of years back, I think 3-4 years back. And one of the marketing heads of that company came up to me backstage and said, we got you to do this show just because I wanted to meet you. Because I was your biggest fan. I was your biggest fan growing up. And that was like, wow. You know, the whole idea of what you mean to somebody in their days of rebellion, youth, and suddenly, you know, them being in a place of power to just come back to you and, you know, give you something in their own way, which was a check for a lot of money. But I was very happy.
A marketing head said that to me also once. She said that we've only called you for the show because I want to have sex with you. So I was like, do I still have to do the show?
Like, so the show was called Hot Love.
I only gave you a quote for one thing. So can we like
double person?
I still did both, but I didn't perform in the show properly.
Can I ask a question? You've also outgrown what you did 10 years ago and tried to do different things. Like, see, for example, a clear example would be
Kapoor moved a lot from the comedy space into actually a far more entrepreneurial space, and then a hosting space in cricket, right? Even for you, Jose, it's been a different thing from radio. You moved into this, and now for a long time, you've actually become a person who took a lot of control into your own creative space. You haven't really said yes to a lot of TV, even though you get offered it.
Taking a decision there has been mostly about money.
Yeah.
Okay. Because at the end of the day, we have to pay our checks.
All of us, yeah.
Pay our bills, sorry. So those decisions for me have always been about that. Leaving television, moving out of radio, television, whatever it is, I've always been worried that, oh my God, will I still be able to sustain?
A lot of perceptions are formed. People like to put you in boxes. So they don't accept the fool and the poet. They only want either the fool or the poet.
Right.
Oh man, don't want
a combination of both.
Correct.
Because I think a combination of both is actually an exciting thing.
When Simi Grewal, I was asking about that because when Simi Grewal became very popular, there's a habit I see now on the net, which is that if something's working, people do it to such a heightened degree that I've become sick of them doing it. You know what I mean? Like I ended 13 episodes of Simi Grewal and never did more because I was like, I'll become this character and then I'm feeding the stereotype also. I'm actually causing my own box to become more tight and more.
That's
big.
Why that my item number career never took off. Because you know, people just keep seeing me as Lola. They were like, she can't do Kala Chashma.
But tomorrow, but if you do 10 Instagram videos of the Pasha
doing Kala Chashma, see, you can change your subset now. Yeah. Right? The democratization of distribution tells you that you can change your subset.
Absolutely.
People hate change. They like you doing one thing. If you naturally have gone towards your evolution as an artist, has taken you to another chapter, or you want to explore another chapter,
right?
You have to balance the art and the commerce in your own head, right? And you do that it works by detaching from the result. So I invest in the process of making whatever I'm making and I'm creating or I'm producing, and then I just detach from the result because it's really A, not in my hands, so it's a logical thing to do. B, that disconnect actually helps me look at the creative process, the creative result as a product, and then helps me optimize the monetization, right? It also depends on what your own risk profile is as an individual, right? Now, this is a conversation that Sahu and I have had last night, right?
Yeah.
Because my issue with risk is that I love it to a destructive level, right? It's just too much. Like Sahukar told me last night about one conversation we had many years ago where I was, and we reached a conclusion that every now and ever so often and too often, I like to just burn everything to the ground and build it up again. I find that that brings me a lot of motivation. It gives me a lot of fire. But it's like as you grow older in life, your responsibilities increase. You can't just keep doing that. You could do it like I did it with Channel V. I had a super comfortable life, a great salary. I was at a point where I was a bit of a bully, where I could pull myself out of shoots and, you know, send other people to do it. I don't know if Yudi knows this, but I'm sorry. It's not the time when you should have learned about
VJs.
This. Should have learned about
VJs.
This.
Yeah.
But I could do that. And I remember I quit. And people were saying, why are you quitting till you find the next thing? I said, because I won't find the next thing till I quit. I just have to let it go. And I did. And for 1 year, that was the part that Sahu and I were talking about, where I had 1 year where I literally made no money. But I was so happy because I was experimenting through different things. Yes, there was no internet at the time.
And you did a short film with a certain someone which never saw the light of day.
Exactly. I did a short film with you. I tried to produce a movie. I tried to gain knowledge. And so I think I even DJed one gig. I was like, I'll just do everything. Let me just see.
You got to have some adversity or something you're failing at on a daily basis keep making you stronger and more interesting. And then your humility as an artist will never go. So then all this bullshit and all these fails, because I've had more self-doubt than anyone I met, man. I mean,
that's why I got married this.
That's why you got married. That's
taking care of this part of
things. Exactly, sister.
How everyone is somehow rooted back to comedy. Now, Manish actually did Pushpavali where he was working with comedians.
Oh, Pushpavali was amazing, by the way. Both seasons were amazing. Sorry, Karan.
I genuinely
love that show. What a great show.
And now, the current comedy scene is exploding, like we know. I mean, it's been bubbling for a while. And
Juhi, did he just say it's shit? that the current comedy scene is shit. Is that what you said?
That's what she said. That'll go in the promo. Did you say that, Juhi?
Wow.
Wow. Insult every comedian in the country just with your line. Like it's
delicious. Yeah, pounds.
I just wanted to be in that panel mode.
Yeah, you know, so here's the thing, right? That these guys are what the influencers are today, all right? Like, and that's the whole point of this conversation, that they have carried forward the trend of what VJs did back then. So most of these people, I honestly didn't know very many of them. I honestly didn't know anything about Sumukhi. I was told that I'm acting opposite her. And I said, okay, cool. Most of them had some reference point of me from Channel V and the things that I did. Like, so we'd hang out a lot on set, right? You know, in between shots, you'd hang out and these guys are on fire. These guys are constantly at it. Like,
Do you jump in or do you keep your distance?
So that's like, the thing, you know, right? I felt a lot of pressure. I used to feel a lot of pressure to jump in. And every time I did, I failed and I bombed. It was awful. So now then by the end of the shoot, it became a thing that, oh, Manish is the guy with bad jokes. So a lot of season two, a lot of the writing of season two was inspired. Like, so when Nikhil does crack a bad joke, it is coming from my real life around these people.
I was checking a message. Did you say that Nikhil Chinappa cracks bad jokes? Or
no,
your
Baba.
Character?
He does, doesn't he?
Your character, Nikhil.
This doesn't affect friendships fall apart slowly. But
wow, he did this for Chinappa.
This doesn't affect me because I believe that if you're compared to somebody who's good, it's amazing for your own like thing. Because
I think Yuri's gonna fucking levitate out of this conversation. Yeah, he's gonna become like this.
I think he already is
seeing his ass.
Because
but you said that Nikhil is not as good as you earlier. I'm just asking.
No, no, comparing you to somebody who's good only makes
words
you
like
better.
Screw Chinappa or to hell with him.
I've had a bit of a business mind since I studied economics. So I said,
"Ki inki biography mein na, main turam
you're an idiot.
Gift tha mere paas.
Mine is hashtag. My autobiography is hashtag humble.
Sister Kapoor hai, jo kahin bhi aap kuch bhi bolenge ga, main ek compliment maari deta hu.
So the thing
he was managing my work also.
Was that the guy who started the improv scene in Bombay? Adam something.
Adam was the first man, UD.
Adam was
the first
man
not to start improv. If you read the right books, he was just the first man. I can't work like this anymore.
What is happening, UD?
There's enough shit going on. You've come up with this Adam bullshit.
No, but I do want to know who started the stand-up scene in India.
I did it.
I think it did. Who are you guys following right now? Who do you like right now? My current favorite is Kusha Kapila. I've just fallen in love with this girl.
Kusha's great. Dolly is lovely. Saloni is so good.
Dolly
so
is really good.
Yeah, her Kangana is very funny. I find her Kangana very funny.
I love so many of them, dude. There's like an army of amazing, amazing people who are just doing so much great, fun, awesome stuff.
I'm a huge fan of obviously Anu. I haven't seen Anu live, but I've seen her special and I laughed. It was insane. Sumukhi is damn good. I think really good. I think she's an incredible writer, which I also then translates into the how she pulls her entire set together.
Even Naveen Richards
is
such a good writer.
Naveen is fantastic.
Fabulous writer, man. Really, yeah. Really good. This was a very good writer also. Like a really interesting writer. I'm not moving away from just the stand-up part. I'm saying as a writer, it's also very good.
Yeah. I think Kannan is great at both writing and performing. I think Kannan's got the right mix of the two. His writing is incredible and the way he performs is also fantastic. But I think urban comedy has become a real thing now.
Yeah, my favorite comedian though does collabs on Instagram with Jose. He's really funny. This guy called Arnab.
Very sensual lips.
Material.
Okay.
But I must say the Hindi stand-up's been on for ages, and those guys go for like 5-7 hours sometimes.
Gaurav's leaving. He has another call, so he's got to go. And this was the last topic of discussion. It was fantastic to have you, Gaurav.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, guys.
Yeah, Gaurav, you can.
I love almost all of you.
Juhi, you're very cute. Every 5 minutes, we start...
This is why I came here, for fucking validation. Validate me.
Yeah, you're
Joseph
the best, Juhi. You're the reason why
Joseph is a cutie.
Bye, everybody. It has been fantastic.
Bye,
Juhi.
Thank you.
And now, guys, we're going to play a game called bank accounts. Bye, guys. Thank you so much. Bye,
just want everyone.
Don't wash your hands. Go out. Hug people. Touch surfaces.
हाँ भाई रावस रावस का क्या रेंज चल रहा है?
Find a random person and lick around the anus.
Oh my god.
Follow Gaurav Kapoor for stuff like that.
Holy shit. I want all my footage deleted from this conversation.
Listen, we should end this like we're on a news debate. I think it's so I just want look.
I was just trying to
think. 1 minute. So I don't understand why.
And there is no reason to insult people like this.
Why was I not supposed to
be on
the
news?
What's the point?
Surfing this massager.